History can define a place, leaving a tangible mark that, while faded, is never forgotten. Forever influencing the character of cities and towns, the personality of their residents, and the experiences of those that visit them. These are special places where the past coexists with the present, melting together to create cultures totally unique to their people and their part of the world. Places like Cappadocia, Granada, Macau, and Český Krumlov. These are cities and towns where the walls can speak, willing to tell their stories to those willing to listen. Places where history is not confined to the past. Locations where time is harder to pin down. These are the world's greatest timeless cities and towns. The nations of Eastern Europe boast histories both varied and proud. Montenegro is one of the world's youngest countries, achieving independence from Serbia as recently as 2006. Yet within it lies one of Europe's oldest towns, Kotor. This fortified port town, fringed by the Adriatic Sea and protected by the bay that shares its name, has stood watch over the surrounding coastline for centuries. Kotor's original story remains lost to time, but it's thought to have arisen from the ruins of the ancient Roman city of Acruvium over 2 millennia ago, the only town on the eastern side of the Adriatic to be referenced in historic maps. The strategic positioning of Kotor has always commanded attention, but not all of it was welcome. The town has been fortified since the Middle Ages to defend against the frequent attacks of foreign invaders. But the medieval ramparts, towers, and bastions seen today are mostly remnants of the Venetian period, which spanned between the 15th and 18th centuries. While the imposing mountain ranges surrounding the town served as a natural barrier to protect its rear guard, the Venetians added over 4 kilometers of battlements in places measuring up to 20 meters high and 15 meters thick to repel the frontal assaults led by seafaring raiders. Invaders that did manage to breach these outer defenses to reach the Venetian old town were met with a series of maze-like streets designed to disorient them, and with their forces divided, were quickly dispatched. Today, as perplexing as ever, navigating the streets of this timeless town is no easy challenge. And it's said that on the odd occasion, even the residents lose their way. Throughout its tumultuous history, Kotor has existed at the crossroads of great empires. And despite the town's imposing defenses, it's been consistently subjected to foreign rule. From the Venetians to the Hungarians and the Austrians, Russians and French. Given Kotor's eclectic history, it's no wonder that the population of this town remains ethnically diverse in the modern era. The old town's marketplaces are timeless melting pots of Balkan and Mediterranean customs and cultures, awash with craftsmen and artisans plying their trades as their families have done for centuries. It's a place in which the past and present coexist in harmony. Many of the buildings here enjoy World Heritage listings while still playing their part in today's modern world. Much of Kotor's enduring architecture is characteristically medieval, thanks to four centuries of Venetian rule. The Venetians can't take all the credit for Kotor's timeless appeal. In the Middle Ages, this busy port town flourished as a commercial and cultural center. It was famous for its schools of art and masonry and was noted for accomplishments in weapon making, goldsmithing, and of course its long-standing maritime traditions, which, as they have done through the ages, continue to sustain Kotor to this day. Legend has it that this tiny island in the Bay of Kotor was made by local fishermen who, having seen an image of the Virgin Mary at this spot, began placing rocks into the bay. Known as Our Lady of the Rocks, in honor of this small church, it's been a long-held tradition for sailors to drop stones into the water as they pass by. Both strengthening the island's foundations and their chances of a safe return to this quaint bayside enclave. Kotor has been nurtured by its natural surrounds, yet protected from the outside world for nearly 2,000 years. Existing in timeless fashion, life here continues to move at its own pace, and the people who call this place home would have it no other way. Macau is an Asian port city that straddles the old world and the new. It's situated 60 kilometers south of Hong Kong, glistening like a jewel in the South China Sea. Macau was once a prized Portuguese colony, but today stands as an autonomous territory within the People's Republic of China. It's a city with a split personality. While exhibiting a decidedly modern face, at its heart, Macau embraces a core steeped in history. One persona is defined by fortresses, churches, and old world influences. The other resonates with the sound of roulette tables and poker machines. Macau is one of the world's preeminent gambling meccas and is often referred to as the Vegas of the East. But as more gaming money changes hands here than any other place on Earth, in reality, this city dwarfs its American rival, Las Vegas. Gambling was legalized here in the 1850s in response to the economic rise of Hong Kong. Today, gaming revenue and tourism form the backbone of the city's booming economy. But there's more to this place than its gaudy hotels and casinos. Macau has a decidedly more refined alter ego. It may be close by, but Macau's old town is set worlds apart from the city's modern distractions. The culture here is a beguiling blend of the island's four-century-long Portuguese history and deep-rooted Chinese influences. The street life is unlike anywhere else on Earth. Tides of mopeds flow along wide boulevards and into narrow cobblestone alleys lined with the Portuguese architecture that, although constructed in the colonial era, continues to define the old town today. This unique collision of worlds is reflective of the profound influence that European colonialism has had on this historic Asian city. But unlike many other colonial territories, Macau wasn't taken by conquest, it was freely given. In 1557, China granted Portugal the right to establish a settlement here in reward for ridding the area of piracy. Under Portuguese rule, Macau was soon transformed from a humble fishing village into a major seaport linking east and west. So valued was Macau by the Portuguese that before the end of the century, the Catholic Church proclaimed it a diocese, paying for the construction of a multitude of churches and cathedrals. A relic of that time, the Church of St. Paul, was constructed in the 17th century. Today, it's in ruins, but in its prime, it was one of the largest Catholic churches in Asia. The church's stone facade was painstakingly carved by Japanese Christians in exile, with the aid of local craftsmen. But in 1835, a typhoon triggered a devastating fire that destroyed the majority of the church's wooden structure. Today, the facade remains as a much-loved icon for the Catholic community that continues to live here. Although the Portuguese and Chinese coexisted and prospered here for centuries, the harmonious confluence of East and West could not last forever. In the 1960s, the Chinese Cultural Revolution stirred tensions in Macau that set the territory on a course that would forever change its destiny. By the end of the 20th century, Macau was the last remaining European colony in Asia. And with the People's Republic of China on the rise, in 1999, it was peacefully handed back to its original custodians with much pomp and pageantry. This historic event marked an end to the once powerful Portuguese Empire. At arm's length from communist China, but not so far from Portugal, Macau's perplexing split personality continues to engage and enthrall, as it has done for centuries. These stone monoliths in the heart of Turkey have been carved by both the forces of nature and the hands of man. The timeless enclave of Cappadocia is a mystical town that leaves a deep impression. Eons in the making, this region is as unique as it is intriguing. The layer of soft stone, known as tuff, that covers the landscape was formed by the solidification of volcanic ash about 70 million years ago. It's since been shaped by the whims of desert winds into a fantastical landscape, characterized by towering formations known as fairy chimneys. Today, it's popularly viewed from the graceful vantage point of hot air balloons. But this otherworldly terrain is equally famous for what lies beneath. It's thought that humans have lived here since the Stone Age. Carving out a niche within the often harsh and unforgiving environment. But the desert wasn't the only challenge to be reckoned with throughout Cappadocia's long history. Rivaling empires with powerful armies, such as the Romans, Greeks, and Persians, surrounded the settlement. In the face of such overwhelming military might, the people of Cappadocia long sought refuge underground. The result is a land shaped not only by natural forces, but by the forces of history. The most famous and well-preserved stonework in Cappadocia dates back to the early days of Christianity. Devout Christians arrived here in numbers during the 4th century, seeking to escape Rome's religious persecution. They created exquisite subterranean places of worship, carving out a monastic existence that in some places survived to the 20th century. But these underground sanctuaries weren't the exclusive purview of religious devotees. To survive the frequent incursions led by hostile neighbors, the Cappadocians constructed more than the odd hiding space. They created entire subterranean cities. Some of these enormous structures measured more than 10 stories deep and were connected to other hidden chambers by a labyrinth of secret tunnels. But in such times of mortal danger, it wasn't enough to simply hide from hostile invaders. The Cappadocians needed to defend themselves. Archaeological evidence suggests that many of these narrow passageways could not only be sealed off with rolling stone doors, but were armed with lethal booby traps. These impenetrable safe havens could house tens of thousands of people, with ample room for livestock and supplies to enable them to wait out the threat. A team of miners could dig out a mansion-sized cavity in the tuff stone in around a week. And upon exposure to air, the newly exposed rock would harden, holding its shape for centuries. Today, these refuges of last resort have been transformed into resorts of luxury. But deep below the desert surface, it's not hard to look beyond modern creature comforts and to take a privileged glimpse of the incredible lives that people have led here since the dawn of history, often retreating below the ground to protect lives and ideologies in a place where history runs deep. Vietnam, a Southeast Asian nation with a long and eventful history, deeply influenced by forces both foreign and domestic. The timeless enclave of Hoi An is nestled between modern cities and heaving resort towns along its central coast. This Vietnamese port city draws life from the mouth of the Tu Bon River, as it has done for over 500 years. Hoi An was founded as a trading port in the 15th century and has managed to retain many of its quaint seaside charms reminiscent of bygone eras. By Asian standards, it's a relatively small city, with a population of just 120,000, leaving it largely free of traffic and pollution. Life here remains simple and uncluttered. As humble as it is today, this little port once had a reach that spanned the globe. Between the 15th and 19th centuries, Hoi An was a vital link in the lucrative spice and silk trade routes between Europe, China, India and Japan. But this port was more than a shipping hub. It was a conduit for ideas, ideals and philosophies that moved in and out of the country in the hearts and minds of transient mariners. Traveling merchants would often sail into port in the spring and await the changing winds of summer to carry them home. By welcoming the world to its shores, Hoi An was forever changed. As the port city's prominence grew, so did its population. Foreign trading companies established colonies here, introducing new architectural concepts, cuisines, and cultures to the local community. And descendants of these foreign traders remain here to this day. Today, Hoi An's shop fronts are crowded with a myriad of traditional tailors and seamstresses, many tracing their family's professions back through the generations to a time when high-quality silk was worth its weight in gold. The face of Hoi An has changed little over the centuries. An eclectic mix of traditional Vietnamese and foreign-inspired architecture line the labyrinth of narrow, cobbled laneways. The river continues to service the needs of the port town as it has done throughout its history. And the street life, although colourful and boisterous, continues to move at a decidedly relaxed seaside pace. Hoi An brings to life a charming slice of a forgotten era. But this port town might have been a very different place in today's world if it were not for one distinct moment in its history. Hoi An was exalted as one of Asia's finest trading ports up until the late 18th century. But its fall from grace was a rapid one. A local rebellion and the growing influence of the French in the region robbed Hoi An of its status. In the late 1700s, the nearby French port town of Da Nang was promoted as the region's new center of trade, relegating Hoi An's future to that of a sleepy backwater. Ironically, it was this loss of favor that led to the preservation of Hoi An's unique heritage. While Da Nang has since grown into a heaving port city, illuminated with neon lights and imbued with all the trappings of the modern world, Hoi An's timeless charm has endured. Without the need for the ever-evolving infrastructure of working dockyards, the city has remained resistant to the forces of modernization for nearly 200 years. A legacy that's allowed the port city to reinvent itself as a modern-day tourist hub, its historic allure once again inviting the world to its shores. Nestled on Spain's Iberian Peninsula, the city of Granada rests at the foot of the Sierra Nevada Mountains, just 10 kilometers from the coast that separates southern Europe from North Africa. Today, it's a bustling modern city, but Granada's long and diverse history is evident at every turn, in its architecture, its culture, and its people. The town was originally founded as a Celtic settlement before briefly falling under the rule of the Roman Empire. But it wasn't until the 8th century Islamic conquests of Iberia that Granada began to truly flourish. In 711 AD, Muslim armies came from Morocco and established a new and far-reaching Islamic territory on the Iberian Peninsula. Granada was quickly developed as one of the region's main cities, and 700 years later, it stood alone as Iberia's last Muslim kingdom. The city as we see it today owes a great debt to that period. During Islamic rule, the Iberian Peninsula was one of the most advanced and stable societies in Europe. And flourishing at its heart, Granada attracted merchants, architects, scientists, and artists that made tangible and lasting impressions which are still evident today. A salient symbol of that vivacious period is the fortress palace of Alhambra, an Arabic phrase meaning the red one. Although the complex was originally constructed in the 9th century, it was continually embellished by a succession of royal families up until the Middle Ages, from which time it was allowed to fall into disrepair. In the early 19th century, the French armies of Napoleon invaded Granada and seized the ruinous fort. But when it became clear that he faced defeat, Napoleon ordered Alhambra's destruction. It's said that a wounded soldier left behind by the retreating army defused not only the bomb that would have destroyed the palace, but Napoleon's act of revenge. Now restored to its former glory, today it stands as a prime example of the wealth and superior technical artistry of Granada's Islamic past. This Moorish complex, hailed as a paradise on earth, is a World Heritage listed site. Granada, the final Muslim stronghold in Iberia, was reclaimed by the Christians in 1492, bringing an end to almost 800 years of Islamic rule in the region. The Christians were quick to place their own mark on the city, erecting churches and cathedrals that to this day rival some of the finest in Europe. As Spain united under a Catholic monarchy, it embarked on a journey of global exploration that, guided by Christopher Columbus, led to the discovery and colonization of the New World and the creation of one of the largest and most powerful empires the world had ever known. A city of significance for not one, but two great empires. Granada's esteemed heritage is proudly maintained and celebrated in its timeless charm and appeal. The region of Bavaria in Germany's southeast plays host to a medieval town of pristine heritage. Regensburg was first settled in the Stone Age and has stood at the confluence of the Danube, Naab, and Regen rivers for almost two millennia. This modest town of just 140,000 residents boasts over 1,500 UNESCO heritage-listed buildings, many of which have been meticulously maintained and preserved since the Middle Ages. Regensburg has withstood the tests of time by changing with the times. It began life as a small Celtic encampment around 500 BC, was transformed into a Roman military stronghold around the time of Christ, and by the 6th century had blossomed into a hub of geopolitical and religious significance. Regensburg was the first capital of the state of Bavaria and the seat of Germany's first parliament. But it wasn't to reach its golden age until the 12th century, a period in which it was reinvented as a thriving hub of trade. The construction of stone bridges across the Danube opened up major trading routes between northern Europe and the rich and powerful Italian city of Venice, which lies nearly 700 kilometers to the south. As money, gold, and silk flowed through the town, Regensburg prospered and was soon regarded as the cultural center of the region. Much of the architecture preserved here owes its existence to the wealthy merchant families of that period, who would endlessly compete with one another to build the largest and grandest structures. In the late Middle Ages, the power of the Western Roman Empire began to wane, and the fortunes of Regensburg followed suit. The establishment of more prosperous trade routes in the region gradually starved the city of its wealth and prestige. Although somewhat diminished, Regensburg retained its status as one of the region's most important religious sites. The town was buoyed by large numbers of Protestant pilgrims whose donations paid to preserve many of its significant architectural structures. At the height of World War II, Allied bombing campaigns hammered the German landscape. On August 17, 1943, RAF bombers strategically targeted a Nazi fighter plane factory and oil refinery on the fringes of Regensburg. But the historic town center was left unscathed. Following the war, Regensburg's economic fortunes were slow to recover. But in this cloud, there was a silver lining. Government spending was restrained, and plans to replace the town's aging buildings with newer structures were delayed. By the time the economic upswing of the 1960s arrived, the value of Regensburg's conservation had been realized. Many of Germany's historic buildings had been damaged or destroyed during the war, making the timeless elements that define Regensburg all the more significant. Thriving in the good times and surviving in the bad, the city of Regensburg has preserved not only its place in the world, but a wealth of irreplaceable heritage. Laos, a Southeast Asian communist nation that has long preserved a traditional way of life inextricably bound with religious reverence. Situated around 300 kilometers from the country's modern political capital, Vientiane, lies the ancient capital of Luang Prabang. As if lost in deep meditation, it's easy to feel that time has stood still here. Luang Prabang blends in with the surrounding jungle, notably lacking the high rises, congestion, and hustle and bustle that define most Asian cities. It's comprised of a number of interlinked villages that, bound by a deep religious connection, work together harmoniously to sustain the region as a whole. Each day in the ancient capital begins with a timeless tradition. At dawn, a procession of monks walks through the streets, accepting offerings from the local residents. Providing the monks with food for the day and the locals with karmic credit. Luang Prabang stands at the sacred confluence of the Mekong and Nam Khan rivers. And its creation is associated with many legends. Buddha himself is said to have smiled as he rested here during his many travels, prophesying that the city would one day become a rich capital. He was right. Between the 14th and 16th centuries, this city was the capital of the powerful kingdom of Lan Xang, for centuries one of the largest kingdoms in Southeast Asia. But by the 1700s, the kingdom had fallen into decline. Branching out on its own, Luang Prabang formed an independent state before eventually agreeing to become a French protectorate in 1889 to avoid being annexed by other powerful forces in the region. As part of French Indochina, the face of the city began to slowly modernize and cultures began to clash. French rule in the region eventually came to an end during the mid-20th century as Lao nationalists won a long and hard-fought independence. Today, the city still bears the mark of French colonialism in its architecture, food, and street life. But despite decades of foreign influence, Luang Prabang's cultural and religious fervor never waned. This timeless town is now considered a national treasure and has become one of the most visited sites in the country, continuing to fulfill an ancient prophecy that long ago foretold of the enduring prominence of Laos' unofficial spiritual capital. The ancient town of Chesky Krumlov is nestled amongst a rural setting in the South Bohemian region of the Czech Republic. The town is surrounded by the rolling hills of the countryside and its historic center by the winding banks of the river from which it derives its name. The name Krumlov is thought to come from the German word for crooked meadow, a reference to the tight bend in the Vltava which governs the town's unique layout. The word Chesky simply means Czech. One can walk Chesky Krumlov's cobblestone streets from one end to the other in just 20 minutes. But to do so would be a travesty, as the timeless charms of this town have been centuries in the making. Occupying a promontory in the town's picturesque center is Chesky Krumlov Castle. The unusually large fortress for a town of this size was founded in the mid-13th century by the Witkowski family, the first of a long line of nobles to rule the area. It was this exultant building and the wealthy nobles that dwelled within that breathed life into the township that arose beneath it. The stewardship of Chesky Krumlov Castle changed hands frequently over the centuries, and as such, it exhibits a variety of Gothic, Renaissance, and Baroque styles of architecture. The unique design and rich history of the castle offers privileged glimpses into centuries come and gone, and has earned it a UNESCO World Heritage listing. One of the more unusual features of the castle can be found amongst its fortifications. In the 16th century, the last member of the Rosenberg line constructed a moat around the inner courtyards to ward off rivals. But instead of filling it with water, he filled it with bears. A controversial legacy that remains to this day. The wealthy nobles that lived here were also great patrons of the arts. Buildings such as the immaculately restored Baroque Castle Theatre continue to stand as testament to their devotion and passion. It's a legacy that can be seen at every turn. Even the streets within this timeless enclave could be considered living, breathing works of art. As many of the facades that line them are intricately adorned with powerful geometric patterns and hand-painted frescoes, forever drawing the eye to the town's striking architecture. Chesky Krumlov has inspired creatives for generations. But there is one that stands out from the crowd. Hidden within the labyrinth of winding cobblestone laneways, the Egon Schiele Art Centrum pays homage to the controversial artist who, in the early 20th century, was reviled for work that exhibited raw sexuality. Today, Egon Schiele is internationally recognized as an early exponent of expressionism, and his vibrant paintings of Chesky Krumlov are widely acclaimed. Much of Chesky Krumlov's enduring architecture owes its heritage to the periods between the 14th and 17th centuries. But it was during the 20th century that this historic town faced its greatest threats. As many of Europe's great cities fell to the unbridled fury of not one, but two world wars, Chesky Krumlov survived relatively unscathed. Today, dominated by its imposing castle, this unique town stands tall as a monument that has transcended the centuries. Timeless cities and towns don't simply preserve history, they keep it alive, blurring the boundaries between past and present. By adhering to ancient traditions and introducing modern innovations, these unique places have fostered cultures neither old nor new. They have forged something timeless. In these places, we're able to experience firsthand the complexities of historic events and gain a sense of the lives of everyday citizens then and now. Perhaps most importantly, these are locations which remind us that the book of history is never closed. And the way in which we live our lives today may have profound impacts upon the lives of those that follow in generations to come.